I'd like to call the Joint House and Senate Higher Education Committee to order. It's about, it is February 7th, 2017. It's about 5:30. We're going to call it 5:30 because I don't know if we're on House time or Senate time, so. But, well, you're out of order. There you go, Representative. But, no, we gather today to make recommendations to the joint convention for the region candidates. And basically, there are a set of rules that we will be adopting, but just to really briefly run through those rules, we will hear each office. So the second, the third, the eighth, and the at-large separately will hear every, nominations will be taken from the, for the second, we'll start with that, we'll go in order. Second, and then we will hear from the candidates. They'll each have 3 minutes, and then we'll have 15 minutes for questions from the committee. And then we will vote on the second. Once that's taken care of, then we move on to the third. We'll do the same procedure through the second, third, eighth, and at-large. So that's, unless you have something, and I will state a quorum is present from both sides, from both House and Senate, so a quorum is present. We would start out by adopting the rules. If I have a motion to adopt the rules that have been available in your packets and at the back table.
I'll make a motion to adopt the rules.
Motion has been made to adopt the rules. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The motion does prevail. Then we will move on to the first, I guess we have on the, as the agenda is number two, comments from the Region Candidate Advisory Committee. Mr. Walter, there we, thank you. Please join us here and welcome to the committee, and please, whatever comments you would like to make, just identify yourself for the record.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the Joint Committee. It's an honor to be with you tonight. My name is Dan Walter. I live in Burnsville. I am Vice Chair of the Regent Candidate Advisory Council. I bring regrets tonight from our Chair, Ardell Brady, the Mayor of Rochester, who's unable to be with you tonight, so you're getting the second string. I know you've got a lot on the agenda tonight, so I won't take too much of your time, but wanted to just provide a refresher on the Regent Candidate Advisory Council and the work that we do. The Regent Candidate Advisory Council was created by the legislature and is established in statute with the purpose of identifying, recruiting, and recommending to this committee at least two and no more than four qualified candidates for each of the open seats on the Board of Regents. The RCAC consists of 24 members, including two students. 12 are appointed by the Speaker of the House, and 12 are appointed by the Senate through their appointment process to six-year staggered terms. We are supported by the staff of the Legislative Coordinating Commission. I want to single out Sally Olson in the audience for the great work that she does in supporting the work of the RCAC. All of our meetings are open to the public and recorded, so you can go online and listen to hours and hours of interviews if you haven't already. As you know, there are four positions on the Board of Regents coming to term in 2017. As said already, one each from the 2nd, 3rd, and 8th Congressional District, as well as one statewide at-large seat. Just a bit about our process. So in the summer of 2016, the RCAC began its work for this cycle. A committee met and reviewed. We reviewed the selection criteria for candidates for the Board of Regents, which I believe is in your packets. It was adopted by the full council in September. At that point, we begin a recruitment process. We begin recruiting candidates through a statewide outreach effort that includes press releases, letters to the editor, direct contact with legislators, our organizations, and extensive individual recruitment efforts made by council members. This year, for the four open spots, we received a total of 36 applications. The RCAC met in December for the preliminary screening of candidates to interview. After extensive discussion and debate, 17 candidates were selected for interviews. We then, the beginning of January 4th, 5th, and 6th, were sequestered here in this building and went through several hours of interviews with these candidates. And each for each candidate, we review an application packet, which I believe you have as well, that includes essay responses to a series of questions that are modified through each cycle. We do a reference check of at least three individuals for each candidate, and then the 45-minute interview with an extensive question and answer period. From the 17 finalists, the council is referring 12 candidates to this committee for consideration. I would would draw your attention, due to redistricting, a current incumbent regent for the 2nd Congressional District, Tom Devine, now resides in the 3rd Congressional District. You'll notice that the RCAC recommended Mr. Devine for both the at-large seat and the 3rd Congressional District, which is where he currently lives. That's why you have 12 names but 13 recommendations from the RCAC. Madam Chair, the members of the RCAC, I know a number of them are here today, appreciate the opportunity to be involved in this process and to help the legislature in this very important important process. I'd also like to recognize the University of Minnesota Alumni Association, which is always actively involved in our process in getting the word out and helping recruit. Also, the Board of Regents office provides a great deal of technical support throughout this process. So, Madam Chair, that concludes my comments.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for all of your work and for all of the committee's work also. Thank you very much. Well, then we will move right into the 2nd Congressional District recommendations, and it is my understanding that the RCAC recommendations that have been made are automatically nominated in a sense. So we have those recommendations were Ian Benson, Jim Carter, and Sandy Krebsbach. Are there other nominations?
Madam Chair,
Representative Christensen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, I nominate Steve Swigum.
We need, according to the rules, we need three hands from the House. Steve Swigum, and two hands from the Senate. We have enough, so thank you very much. Steve Swigum's name has been put into nomination for CD2. Further nominations? I would declare nominations closed. So the four nominees will please come forward. And according to the rules, they each have a 3-minute presentation, and then we would ask questions. So Mr. Swigum, Mr. Benson, Mr. Carter, and Ms. Krebsbach, please. I think there's enough chairs there. Mm-hmm. And we'll go in alphabetical order for the opening statements. Like I said, you each have 3 minutes. And who will be timing? The timer will be right here, right next to me, Mr. Fossum. So alphabetical order, we would start with Mr. Benson.
I do go first.
Yeah. Well, that's the disadvantage or advantage of having a B for a last name. So.
I think it's probably both.
So Mr. Benson, whenever you're ready, please. And we'll, sure. The timer's right here.
Okay.
Thank you.
Chair Fischbach, Chair Norns, Joint Committee members, I am thrilled to be here and to be a candidate for the Regent of the University of Minnesota. Please let me tell you a little bit about myself, who I am, what the university means to me, and why I would be a great regent. I am a first-time candidate. It's a very interesting process. I'm from Rosemount, Minnesota. I am an immigrant. I was born in the United Kingdom. I was raised as a Minnesotan by British parents. I have 3 university degrees, 2 from the University of Minnesota, 1 in engineering and 1 in mathematics. I also have an MBA from the University of St. Thomas through their executive program. I have served 21 years as a commissioned officer in the United States Navy, both on active and reserve duty, primarily in the Pacific Fleet and the Pacific Rim Commands. I retired as a commander, and if you don't speak Navy ranking, that's a lieutenant colonel. So I've been leading for 22 years. I have 25 years with Xcel Energy. I started as an engineer. I'm a vice president in operations. I lead a group of 12 groups in 3 cities that take care of 4 transmission systems that span 10 states. It's a capital-intensive part of our business, and we invest hundreds of millions of dollars in those transmission systems every year. So I know what it takes to be successful as an organization, and that's metrics, it's vision, it's calibration, it's collaboration, it's prioritizing, it's compromising, and it's trying to do more with less. In fact, not just more with less, it's doing more better with less. Why do I want to be a regent? The University of Minnesota was transformational in my life, and I just want to pay it forward. I know it's a different university than 1979. Tuition is no longer $870 for a year. The demographics of Minnesota are different. The training of Minnesota is different. The technology of Minnesota is different, but the importance of the University of Minnesota is the same. And actually going forward, it's going to continue to change. I'd like to see a vision for 2030, maybe even 2035. 2035 is when a child born today will be going into higher education. In the past month, I've met with senators and representatives, Republicans and Democrats. I've listened to what they had to say, many of the members here on the Joint Committee and many in the 2nd Congressional District, and I have three takeaways. One, legislative assistants are amazing. Two, there is a universal love for the University of Minnesota. And I'll use one statistic to capture all of the University of Minnesota, and that's 15,000 degrees a year, and I think that that's absolutely fantastic. Also, I've heard of angst about the administration, angst about the regents, angst about the relationships, and angst with the relationships with the legislators. I'm going to shout out to one representative who took the time to educate me on some of the past tuition, the budgets, and actually shared some of the historical documents of years and years ago. I'd like to end with, I'm actually experiencing higher education. I have two children that are university graduates, and one is a grad student at the University of Minnesota. He's here today, and I'm really grateful.
Mr. Benson, you're going to finish up. We did call time, so.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
And thank you.
And we have 3 minutes for Mr. Carter. Please start when you're ready.
Thanks. Good afternoon. James Baldwin said that not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it's faced. You have a choice. Are we going to continue to have an excellent university, or are we going to start the decline? Do we want to soldier on the way things are going, or do we want it to change? The Regent's job is very difficult and demands intelligence, but it also screams for common sense. The higher education model we are using no longer appears to be working. Two things are abundantly clear to me. Number one, we can't survive if we continue to spend almost $1 billion a year on administrative costs, including consulting, attorney fees, and defending lawsuits. Even if we change the names of what we call these administrative costs, we still can't afford it. Number two, trying to operate a university this size with no strategic long-range plan is pretty silly. As a matter of fact, it's impossible. And some might say it's a definition of insanity. Whether you elect me or somebody else, I hope that these two things get changed immediately. By the way, you better hurry, because the Regents this Friday are going to vote to change the reservation and delegation of authority rules of the Board of Regents bylaws, and they're going to allow the president to make huge financial decisions, like the $26 million they just spent to fire one football coach and hire another, only he'll be doing it without board approval. Every senator or representative I've talked to, and many of you are among them, and every thinking person I've run into in the community says the university spending is out of control and is crazy, and it needs changing. That change would be my mission and my goal if I was elected to the Board of Regents. If you'll excuse a sports metaphor, the Board of Regents is like a team. I've played on a lot of teams my whole life. And in every football team I was on, from midgets to bantams to high school to college to the Green Bay Packers, I was elected as a leader. I was chosen to be captain of every one of those teams. Not because I wasn't hard on people, not because I babied them, not because I wanted to be everybody's friend. They chose me because I had the courage to make them better, to make myself better. I called them out when they weren't working hard and they weren't engaged. And they knew I was a grinder and that nobody would outwork me.
And that is time.
I'll do the same on the board. Thanks.
Ms. Kresbach, please.
Okay. Thank you very much, Chair Fischbach and Chair Nornes. I am very proud to be a candidate for Regent. And what I want to assure you that if I am selected, my focus will be to bring the university back to its magnificence, which it has experienced in the past and can experience again. I've met with all of you, or most of you, and I do want to thank you for your time. And I heard a universal concern about the University of Minnesota, how it is managing money, its access for Minnesota students, and the problem with the medical school. And so one of the things that I will assure you is that I will be working towards a major strategic plan for the University of Minnesota. And it needs to be the engine, and it is the engine of our economy. It's the lifeblood of innovation and the one common resource that we all have a stake in together, no matter where we live, and in all of your districts and other districts as well. And the many multiple ways of access to the university due to the land-grant mission of teaching, outreach, and research. I am, my background is, I actually have a PhD from the University of Minnesota, and I work with technical ed nationally. So I'm always working with innovation and what is ahead. And it, for many of you, I've talked about the relationship between technical ed and research. If research is happening, somebody in technical is moving along, and also industry works with it, whether it's the power industry or other industries. And I've been the mayor of Mendota Heights and elected for 24 years. And so I know public governance. I know a packed room with angry residents about a particular situation and how you manage through that. I'm able to keep a calm demeanor, hear people out, and move things forward. Mendota Heights has a AAA bond rating, 11,000 people. The reason I mention that is it's one of 50 cities nationally, a population under 12,000 that has a AAA rating. That is a metric of leadership and management. We also manage by losing 400,000 in local government aid. We absorb that and move through that. As a city leader, I've moved the city through a crisis of the loss of Scott Patrick, our police officer, on July 30th, 2014. Did that with a very steady eye, moving everyone through and responding to the press as appropriate. I have the balance and the leadership to be effective and a productive regent. I am not someone who just kind of looks the other way. As I mentioned in one of my interviews, I happen to be able to pick up the rock. I don't necessarily always want to be able to do that, but I have that ability. And to move organizations through things that might require urgency and also might take more long-term outcomes. And what I will focus on as a regent is, first of all, the strategic plan, looking at the next iteration of the operation of excellence and find savings, and I'll know where to look because I come out of this world. Restore the prominence of our medical school, looking at the relationship with Fairview or other medical providers. Also, a recommitment to the land grant mission, and look at the issues of tuition and student access.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Mr. Swigum.
Madam Chair and members, life changes very quickly sometimes. I had a plan to be at a high school basketball game tonight about 3 hours ago. Madam Chair, Mr. Chair, senators and representatives, we all love the University of Minnesota. That's not a question. We are not a question of who loves it more or doesn't love it more. We all know that the university contributes to, no, it drives. The university drives the state of Minnesota. It drives our economy. It drives our businesses. It drives our jobs. It drives our health. It drives the information and the services that we receive as citizens of this state. It drives this state. Some years ago, and I give a compliment to you as senators and representatives to have followed through on that, when I was sitting in a different chair, maybe a chair on your side of the table, I used to have members of the university, including the presidents, come into my office often. And I would tell them that it's about performance. You need to perform to justify the dollars you receive from the citizens of this great state. You need to perform. And I'd look at President Brunix and I said, you got to retain freshmen. You have to graduate students in 4 or at least 5 years, maybe 6, but at least get them graduated before 8 years. You have to be able to graduate students in science and technology. You have to cut down those administrative costs. The administrative costs, members, that very honestly, between 2000 and at least 2011, from which I remember, grew significantly, and the costs were just shifted onto students. The university did not do the job of becoming efficient like all of your cities, including Mendota Heights, Minneapolis, counties, and the legislature did. The university did not do that. We need to become more efficient. We need to reward the university and the citizens based upon their performance. In 2013, you started to do that with some small amount of money aimed at the university on performance. That's good. It needs to be enhanced. It was just a chip off the block. We need to do more. But the performance has to come from the university to you and to the citizens of the state to justify the dollars which you give the university in order to drive the engine of the state of Minnesota. The five campuses, the seven agricultural experiment stations, I guess they're not called agricultural experiment stations right now, but those seven,
and that's
seven
time, Mr.
campuses
Swigum.
are vital to our state, and I would like to contribute to that.
Thank you very much, all four of you. Thank you. And now we will we'll start the 15 minutes for questions from Representative Pawlowski.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My question has two parts. Should the Regents of the University of Minnesota be voting on the multi-million dollar athletic contracts that have now become a plague for the university? And the second part of the question is, should Regent votes be recorded publicly? So it's a two-part question.
And what I'm doing is just taking it so we'll have, so since Mr. Benson went first, I'm going to switch it down. So Mr. Carter will go first on this one. I made a little chart. So
my question is absolutely yes to both questions.
Ms. Craig.
Well, I'm familiar with having an amount at which a body makes a decision, so I would set an amount. I'm not sure what the amount is, and it sounds to me like it needs to be a lower amount in which the Regents weigh in, and I'm used to a public vote, absolutely.
Mr. Swigum.
Madam Chair, Representative Pawlowski, when you spend $3.8 billion, much of that public funds, it better be recorded and it better be public. And where you and I both can agree that athletics probably should not drive a major institution like the university. There are other programs much more important. When you go to the coffee shops and you go to the hairdresser or the cosmetology office, you go to church, what do people talk about? They talk about the disastrous contracts which are being paid off. And yeah, I think we should we should be voting on those and should be public.
Mr. Benson.
Oh, I didn't get up here very quickly. Chair Nornes and Chair Fischbach and Representative Pawlowski, I don't believe that the Board of Regents should get into the minutia of some of the administration, but the answer to your first question is that's not the minutia. And so the answer is yes. I believe that the Regents should be involved in that. And public votes, absolutely yes.
Further questions? Senator Clausen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. a question from Mr. Swigum. As you mentioned, 3 hours ago, you weren't thinking about being a Regent. These other candidates have gone through a vetting process. Why should we consider you?
Madam Chair, Senator Clausen.
Actually, excuse me. Oh, it was specific to you. I'm sorry. We were trying to make sure. Go ahead if you'd like to. I'm sorry. I apologize. No. I apologize. That was my fault. I have to say I was distracted just a bit. So Representative Swigum, go ahead if you'd like to.
Well, I would rather have someone else answer.
No.
Senator Clausen, first of all, my words were I was going to a basketball game that night. That did not mean I didn't want to be a Regent to the University of Minnesota. So I wanted to make sure your question be phrased correctly. Secondly, while I did not go through the RCAC process this year, I did go through the RCAC process 6 years ago and was recommended by RCAC 6 years ago. So I did not go through it right now, but I did 6 years ago.
And I did intend to let everybody, so if you would like to, you can address that too. So it would start with Ms. Kresbach if you'd like to.
I'll pass on that. Thank
anybody
you.
Else? No, okay. Is it Representative Pryor?
Yes, thank
Representative
you.
Pryor, I was.
Chair. My question for all of you,
My question for all of you is to comment on the process. I had the, you know, the honor and the pleasure of sitting in my office and speaking with two of you and getting to know you, what your views are, how you would perform. And I appreciate that time that you spent with me. But what about the process that some people here tonight I have not met with and, in fact, didn't know before I walked in the room and we heard the nominations that you would be before us? And, you know, my question is, I am an elected representative. I represent a district. I represent the state. And I feel like I'm not doing my job when I didn't have an opportunity to talk to people before tonight. And I have to make a decision based on very little information. So the question is, what do you think about the process?
And we will start with Ms. Kresbach.
Well, first of all, my experience, again, is a city government, and we've appointed commissioners, and we typically work with the people that apply and interview them. But there is on occasion where you may not have the candidate that you actually wanted. I'm talking more about like a major hire in a department. So I understand, you know, bringing in somebody that, and it's my district. I mean, I'm a nonpartisan, so I'm not a political rock star, so to speak. But if that's more of the type of larger known personality politically, then I understand why you'd be bringing in another candidate. So, and do you want me to comment on the process in general? Well, I'm new to this. I thought the committee was a very good interview. The thing you don't understand is exactly how you're going to campaign to be a regent. And the end product of being a regent is one type of skill set and ability. And that doesn't mean you have that as a campaigner. You know, I've had somebody say, you know, try to promote yourself more. To me, it's about the university, how I make decisions and how I would function in that role. But it's also about having you get to know any of us in terms of what we bring to the table. What I do like about the process is I've met almost all of you, and I really do like that. It's very human. It's very connected, and because there's concern about the university, I plan, if I am the regent, to come back and meet with you. It's not like over. This was all of your effort and my effort over 5 weeks. This needs to go somewhere. And in the other forum, I said I would like to see a stakeholder meeting with the regents and with this committee, with this joint committee. So thank you for the time.
And then we are going to Mr. Swigum.
Madam Chair, Representative Pryor, first of all, I'd like to get to know you and get to know you better, as well as everybody else on the committee better. Having been one who has successfully gone through the RCAC process, albeit a few years ago, I would tell you that I am not very supportive of the process. With all due respect to my friend, Mr. Walter, with all due respect to the members of the RCAC committee, I would tell you that I am not a great supporter of that process. I think it is the Constitution that says you folks are the ones that will be making the decision.
Mr. Benson.
Well, I'm a first-time candidate, and I was not familiar with this process at all, and it is a very weird process. The highlight for me is I get to meet so many representatives and senators, and that's been fantastic. Does this process lead to the best regent? I don't know that it does. I think it potentially leads to a certain kind of regent, and perhaps every 2 years when we go through this process, it's the same kind of regents. And I think with 12 regents, we want a little bit of diversity in there, diversity of the way they think, and I'm not sure that that comes out of this process.
Mr. Carter?
I don't have a strong opinion on the process. I'm not very fond of it. I think it's too bad that it gets to be a situation where the likelihood is that you folks are put in a position where you don't vote your conscience, you vote your party. And I think that's difficult, but I think it's life, and this is how things work. I spent a lot of time in Wisconsin. Over there, the governor appoints the boards of regents, and I'm not sure that process is much different. I don't like to be critical of something if I don't have a better solution, and I don't in this case, so I'll leave it at that. Thanks.
Further questions from the committee? We only used 8.5 minutes. Well, thank you all very much, I guess, and we will go on, we'll proceed to the voting. Thank you all very much. And we do have the four names in nomination, and it is done by roll call. And if you have not read the rules, they need to get a majority from both the House and a majority from the Senate. So they need it on both sides. So unless there's further discussion, seeing none, are you take the, do they take, do you take it, or are they taking it, the roll? Okay, so the Senate will take the Senate side, and I guess we can start with the Senate, and then you guys take the House side, is the way I understand. So if you don't mind, we'll proceed with the Senate, if that works for you. So please, take the roll on the second district. Okay.
Chair Fischbach?
Swigum.
Vice Chair Dreheim? Senator Clausen?
Krebsbach.
Senator Abler?
Swigum.
Senator Anderson?
Swigum.
Senator Cohen?
Krebsbach.
Senator Isaacson?
Krebsbach.
Senator Jensen?
Swigum.
Senator Newton?
Carter.
The House will take the roll.
Chair Nornes?
Swigum.
Representative Christensen?
Swigum.
Representative Pulowski?
Krebsbach.
Representative Albright?
Swigum.
Representative Anselmo?
Krebsbach.
Representative Bernardi?
Krebsbach.
Representative Daniels?
Swigum.
Representative Haley?
Swigum.
Representative Heintzman?
Swigum.
Representative Jessup?
Swigum.
Representative Lean?
Benson.
Representative Omar?
Krebsbach.
Representative Pryor?
Krebsbach.
Representative Schultz?
Krebsbach.
Representative Whalen? Swigum. Representative Zerwas?
Swigum.
Having received the required votes from both the House and the Senate, Mr. Swigum has been recommended by the committee to the joint convention. Thank you all very much for running in the second, and I don't know the date of the joint convention, but we will move on to the, I think it's either the 22nd or the 23rd, but so he will be recommended to the joint convention. We will move on to the recommendations in the third. Nominated by the RCAC, Walt Erickson, Tom Devine, Darren Rocha, and Tammy Lee Stanock. They will be placed in nominations. Are there any further nominations in the third? Any further nominations for the CD3? Yeah. And just as a reminder, there was a caucus for the third congressional district, and it is available in your packets. So there's a letter from Senator Limmer, who is the third congressional district convention chair. I'm sorry, so thank you all for joining us, and we will go in alphabetical order for the opening statements, and then I'll kind of do the same kind of, so we'll go second, third then. But so the first opening statement will be given by Mr. Devine, so please go ahead.
Good evening, Chairman, Chairwoman, and members of the Joint Higher Education Committee. Thank you for the opportunity to appear here before you for my candidacy to be reelected to the Board of Regents of the University of Minnesota.
I'm humbled, and it has been an honor and a privilege to serve you and the people of Minnesota. As a product of St. Paul Public Schools and the University of Minnesota, I understand the importance of a strong public educational system. This education propelled me in a career as a fourth-generation insurance broker and set up a firm foundation for my many volunteer and community and governance outreach roles that I've had. Being on the Board of Regents is a meaningful experience, and we have a hand in shaping the future of Minnesota. The students that we touch make for better citizens of the state of Minnesota, the country, and the world. The research we support will lead to a healthier, smarter, and more economically driven Minnesota. The outreach we facilitate improves the quality of all of the life of Minnesotans. However, these impacts do not come, or these are overcome and do not just occur in a very complex organization. They originate from a great responsibility to work collaboratively with the administration, the faculty, the students, and the staff to improve all five campuses. I've embraced that responsibility and by taking a very bridging presence within the board between our seasoned and new regents, young and old. While acting within the traditions and cultures of the Board of Regents, I have also been a sincere agent for change and an advocate for a focus on student-centered outcomes. Some of the board's accomplishments over the past 5 years have highlighted my advocacy for change. The adoption of a comprehensive enrollment transfer student plan admitting hundreds more of Minnesota students. Significant improvements in our 4-year graduation rates and GPAs. Advanced our Minnesota MnDrive public-private collaboration of 106 new businesses. And stressed fiscal accountability, $90 million to date, and adopted the strategic plans from 5 of our individual campuses. We've led to a number of other efforts related to the aquatic invasive species issues, and by way of a new research facility, the St. Paul campus have tackled an issue very important to a number of people across Minnesota. I believe my track record and my undeniable commitment and collaborative mindset has served and will continue to serve the university well. I humbly ask this joint committee for your endorsement this afternoon or this evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We didn't even have to call time. Mr. Erickson.
Madam Chair and Chair Nornes, Senators, Representatives, thank you very much for your consideration this evening. You know that all 4 of us are qualified to be regents. My specific qualifications come from running a large, complex organization and dealing with the strategic issues that come with that territory. Many of you also know that I just retired and I'll devote significant time to this process, much more time than I think is advertised as 40 hours a month. I think it's much larger than that. But this whole process has made me a whole lot more enthusiastic about the university than when I first started. In business, my go-to strategic planner was the Cheshire Cat in Alice in Wonderland. And to paraphrase, he said, if you don't know where you're going, then nearly any road will get you there. And I do think that the university at this time needs a strategic reset. We need to find the reset button. I'm a good strategy guy, and I do believe that I can contribute to that. First, we need an enterprise-wide strategic plan that recognizes that we are one university, but that we deliver significant value to students and to Minnesota from 5 campuses. Second, we need a brand management strategy that recognizes that we are the University of Minnesota. Gophers, UMD, driven to discover, all of those are simply second lines in that brand. We are the University of Minnesota. We will attract students, research dollars, and alumni donations to that brand, and we must protect that brand with a crisis management strategy, which we don't have in place. Third, we need to fix our medical school. It's drifting from a lack of consistency and poor choices in partnerships and in research. And finally, and most important, we need to honor our core value of being a land-grant institution. Limiting enrollment and affordability is bad policy and it's bad strategy. Limited enrollment is bad public policy because it exacerbates income inequality and it creates a whole new class of educated elite, if you will.
It's also bad strategy. If you consider our top-line growth problems, it stops us from growing our top line because we can't enroll any more students. And the selectivity that we do, that we use to create that selective environment, says that you build more buildings and you add more expense, so you're building your fixed cost base as well. Bad strategy. Third, limited enrollment doesn't challenge the university to deliver education using available technology wherever and whenever there is demand. And fourth, limiting enrollment allows us to follow a traditional classroom approach, which leaves in place all of the expense structure that causes high student loans and high student debt. We should focus on students and research, but in that order. We should look at new ways to deliver education at a lower cost.
And that would be time, sir.
And we should educate more students.
Thank you. Mr. Rocha?
Thank you, Chair Fischbach, Chair Nornes, members of the Joint Higher Ed Committee. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. Please let me give you a brief background, after which I'll touch on the past 2 years serving as a regent in this position and a view forward. Raised just outside of Owatonna, I followed my sister to the university as a first-generation college student, enrolling at the College of Agriculture. I completed a degree in agricultural economics before finishing a poli-sci degree in CLA, then enrolled in public affairs and law, finishing my law degree. I still owe Humphrey a Plan B paper, which I'm sure they'll be happy to accept 27 years late. In fact, they don't even require the paper anymore, but I'm reverse grandfathered. Nonetheless, while at the College of Ag, I was selected to be an at-large member of the Board of Regents in the student regent position and served from 1989 to 1995. Since then, I practiced law, and for the past 4 years, I've served as general manager and counsel for Crutchfield Dermatology in Eagan, Minnesota. I am approaching my 27th anniversary in the Minnesota Army National Guard, where I've been a medic, armor officer, and judge advocate. I served as chief of operational law for the Red Bulls in our southern Iraq deployment from 2009 to 2010. I've served as a military judge, and I now serve as the command judge advocate of the 347th RSG in Brooklyn Park. My wife Valerie and I have three small children under eight and live in Independence on a small acreage in western Hennepin County. During my first term as regent, the board was critically reviewing the university's operations after challenging times in the late 1980s. The administration worked closely with the board and in coordinating with the legislature, state leaders across higher ed, and community leaders across the state to restructure the university and all of state higher ed to more effectively and efficiently use diminishing state dollars to educate a growing percentage of Minnesotans who were pursuing higher education. When I returned to the board 20 years later, I discovered that our goal then of turning a campus of 55,000 with a low graduation rate into one with 35,000 students with a high graduation rate and national standing had been, for the most part, very successful. That change was not easy, and with robust discussion and even disagreement on the board, we closed programs and gained efficiencies, all through very concerted strategic planning. We work closely with the legislature and other higher ed institutions to improve credit transfer and admission processes necessary to make those changes. All this came through careful outward-looking system-wide strategic planning by the board and the administration. Fast forward to 2015, I have been very impressed with the success of the university in teaching and research. We have a well-prepared student body and we continue to conduct important research. This is terrific. That said, we have significant challenges. The cost of attendance has greatly outpaced inflation, and for many, it's a barrier to entry. Despite Minnesota having the best ACT scores in the country and among the top high school graduation rates, we have an unusually high non-resident enrollment despite having the lowest non-resident tuition in the conference. We also have administrative costs that far exceed my previous experience. While this might be reflected also at other institutions, I do not believe that we must accept this as inevitable. Most significantly, we have been operating without a system-wide strategic plan. It's one of the first things I brought up when I was elected to the board and looked at the budget. And this is what I want to work at going forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Ms. Stanek?
Thank you. We just have to switch chairs here. Thank you, Chairs Fischbach and Nornes and members of the Joint Committee. It's an honor to appear before you tonight as a candidate for Regent. I bring to this role 2 decades of corporate and civic leadership. I've led at large companies like Northwest and Delta Airlines and Carlson Companies, and I've also worked to develop strategies to mitigate risk, a skill set that would be well used right now on the Board of Regents. I know the U from the inside, having worked there at the University of Minnesota Foundation, and now from the outside, now serving as a senior executive for Recombinetics, a biotech company founded by university graduates and faculty. At Recombinetics, we collaborate with about 20 different University of Minnesota researchers to find cures for some of the most vexing health challenges, diabetes, cancer, heart disease, and Alzheimer's. The U needs partnerships like these, and companies like ours really need the University of Minnesota's Medical School to be a magnet for research funding and innovation. Unfortunately, we've slipped to number 35 in the research rankings, and I know that we can certainly do better than that, and we can get there through stronger public-private partnerships. It's important to note that the land-grant mission of the University of Minnesota extends far beyond the Twin Cities. We are a system of campuses, each excellent in its own right. I grew up in Kensington, Minnesota, which is about 20 miles from the University of Minnesota Morris campus. UMM is a great liberal arts school for a great value. It's also a magnet for environmental science, for future teachers, and for Native American students. The Crookston Ag and STEM campus is critical to our farming economy and also to creating the workforce of the future. Duluth offers an excellent rural doctors program, a prosperous school of business and economics, and a world-class Large Lakes Observatory. And Rochester fills a niche with health sciences and bioinformatics. The University of Minnesota is a system, and that system as a whole should be greater than the sum of the parts, but they all need to roll up into a strategic plan and a balanced budget. Here, cost containment is critical. I have an MBA, and I've managed budgets as large as $20 million, and I've also worked in severely cash-constrained environments. Keeping our costs down is not only good for business at the U, it also stabilizes tuition rates, which is a critical challenge. We must make the U more affordable and more accessible to more Minnesota students. And we must stop the brain drain of talent leaving the state. But we must also make all of our campuses more safe and welcoming for everyone. The University of Minnesota is at a critical inflection point. Creating a culture of accountability and transparency starts at the top, and the next regents will really determine the course of the future over the next several years. To this, I bring broad-based expertise in reputation and risk management. I will be a careful steward of the taxpayer and tuition dollars, and I will build stronger bridges between the University of Minnesota and the private sector to help restore our medical school to its rightful place of research excellence. Together, we can deliver great benefits for generations of Minnesotans to come. This is our land-grant mission, and this is the charge for the next Board of Regents. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there questions? Representative Plowski.
I'll repeat the question from the first group. Should the Regents be voting on the multi-million dollar athletic contracts that often result in many times that amount of payout to the university? And should all, I'll add this, should all Regent votes be recorded?
Mr. Erickson?
Yes and yes.
Mr. Rocha?
Representative Pulowski, yes. It is a fundamental role of a board. And moreover, it has to be somewhat concerning that the administration would not want to partner with the board on issues of such major public interest and of significant financial impact. With respect to recording votes, I believe all non-procedural votes should be recorded for public review.
Ms. Stanek?
Yes, the corporate board of directors approves all executive compensation packages, and yes, I fully support recorded votes.
Mr. Devine?
Yes, the Board of Regents should be approving the contracts of the coaches and along with all of the other L employees that we currently are doing right now. And in relationship to the recorded votes, most of the votes are recorded both publicly by videotape that we have in our proceedings, and the committee votes are not, and I would advocate that we do record the video things of committee meetings that we have and make those available to the public.
Further questions? Representative Pryor?
A new question. I am from the third, and I know, you know, our system is that we have representation from regents from each district. And so does that suggest to you that you have a special obligation to the district that you represent, that you, or, you know, what would that mean to you as a regent, that you're the regent from the third congressional district?
We will start with Mr. Rocha.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Representative Pryor. You know, my perspective is that the wisdom of the state rule providing for a regent from each of the districts is that you would have people from each of the districts that would bring the flavor and understanding of their district to their role of the regent. I have not seen, and this was a discussion that we had 30 years ago in my first election, was whether we serve as essentially representatives of the people of the state to the university. And that was the model under which I was raised, and I think it's a good model, so that you don't pursue it as a parochial matter, but you certainly understand the needs of your district and ensure that people from that district have a voice on the board to ensure that its citizens, particularly its young people coming through the system, have an opportunity to maximize use of the university.
Ms. Stanek?
Yes, I agree. We're elected to represent the people of the 3rd District and to have relationships with legislators and constituents in that district. But really, we have to take a statewide approach as well. So it's kind of a dual role. It's part of why I talked about the university being a system of 5 important campuses and not just the Twin Cities campus. I think we have a keen responsibility to represent the entire state in the interests of the system. So I take a both-end approach, similar to what Mr. Rocha mentioned. We represent our districts, but we also represent the state system as a whole.
Mr. Devine?
When we take our oath of office as a regent, we're sworn in as a constitutional officer of the state of Minnesota. We swear away our political allegiance and our geographical allegiance at that point to represent the people of Minnesota and to represent totally what is in the best interest of the University of Minnesota collectively. And I've upheld that all the way through my 5.5 years that I've been a regent, and I take great pride in the fact that the board generally follows that that mode of how we conduct our business collectively as a board.
And Mr. Erickson.
So while I agree that you represent the entire state of Minnesota, I do think that your constituency needs someone to talk to. So when there is some communication needs to be made, then there is a 3rd District Regent, perhaps, that that person comes through. Or when there's a request of the Board of Regents, the communication can take place that way. But other than that, no political positions particularly should be espoused.
Further questions from the committee? Seeing none, thank you very much. And we will proceed to, if there's no further discussion, any discussion from the committee? Seeing none, we'll proceed to the roll call. And just to mix it up a little bit, we'll start with the House.
Chair Nornis.
Rocha.
Representative Christensen.
Rocha.
Representative Plowski.
Rocha.
Representative Albright.
Rocha.
Representative Anselmo.
Rocha.
Representative Bernardi.
Stanek.
Representative Daniels.
Rocha.
Representative Haley.
Rocha.
Representative Heinzman.
Rocha.
Representative Jessup.
Rocha.
Representative Lean.
Stanek.
Representative Omar.
Stanek.
Representative Pryor.
Oh, Stanek, I'm sorry.
Representative Schultz.
Stanek.
Representative Whalen.
Rocha.
Representative Zerwas.
Rocha.
And the roll call from the Senate.
Chair Fischbach.
Rocha.
Vice Chair Dreheim.
Rocha.
Senator Clausen.
Devine.
Senator Abler.
Devine.
Senator Anderson.
Rocha.
Senator Cohen.
Devine.
Senator Isaacson.
Stanek.
Senator Jensen.
Rocha.
Senator
Rocha.
Having received the required numbers from both the House and the Senate, Mr. Rocha will be recommended to the Joint Convention. Thank you all very, very much for the 3rd District. And now I will turn the chairmanship over to Representative Nornis.
Thank you, Senator Fischbach. And we have the 8th District in front of us now. The committee advanced David McMillan and Curtis Teberg. Are there any other nominations?
Mr. Chair.
Senator Fischbach.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to nominate Becky Hall. And there's a second.
A second, okay.
So from the House.
We have 1, 2, 3. We have the required number. So Becky Hall will also be I was not informed until just now that the T-Bury is not here because of a family emergency.
Is that my understanding? That was my understanding.
Anyone have any further information than that?
In my understanding, we were informed of that this morning by the RCAC, that there was a family emergency, so he shouldn't be here. But his name still is in nomination.
Yeah, so he still is officially in nomination, and we just will not be able to hear from him tonight, that's all. So we have two in front of us, and I guess if we continue with the alphabetical route, then Becky Hall, you'll be first.
Okay, thank you, committee chairs and members, for the opportunity to speak with you this evening about my desire to serve as a University of Minnesota regent. My name is Becky Hall, and I am a University of Minnesota alum who resides in Duluth with my husband and five wonderful children. As a mom raising kids in this great state, quality education is always at the forefront of my mind, especially college. I chose to seek the nomination for this position when I learned of the minimal recruitment effort and the lack of enthusiasm in our region for applicants seeking to fill this important role. I'm here to offer up my unequivocal and enthusiastic desire to represent our region on the board, and here's why. I am so grateful for the excellent education I received at the University of Minnesota, and am proud that our state can offer such high-quality education to our citizens. At the signing of the Morrill Act in 1862, Abraham Lincoln said that the land-grant university system is being built on behalf of the people who have invested in these public universities, their hopes, their support, and their confidence. As a regent, I want to focus on supporting that role, which first and foremost continues to provide a quality education to the Minnesota families who invest in our institutions. Raising kids in Minnesota, educating them in Minnesota, gives us a better shot as a state that they will stay in Minnesota, raise their families here, and contribute in many other ways to our great state. I also believe strongly in common sense budgeting, transparency, and accountability on the Board of Regents, which requires an honest and balanced approach to the university's funding priorities. That means, as a regent, being forthright and asking some tough questions regarding budgeting priorities, a solid code of ethics to support us in a very positive manner when issues arise that hinder our stellar reputation. Do we connect with and represent Minnesota students and their families as much as possible? And how do we continue to strive in making the University of Minnesota the shining star that our state can be proud of, that our nation will envy, and our students will have the best opportunities for success? Does our strategic planning concisely address these questions? My goal as a regent would be to ensure that it does with enthusiasm and endless energy. So, for me, the focus or priority should consider Minnesota students and families first by keeping tuition affordable to them, fostering a positive image of our system, properly balancing our fiscal responsibilities, and support research and development that focuses on making the most of Minnesota's resources, technology, and ingenuity. Here's what I can offer the Board of Regents: balance. I can bring the perspective of a mother with one college graduate and three more attending college in the fall, who understands the issues that face Minnesota families who strive and sometimes struggle to support their children's desire for a quality education in their home state. I also offer a wealth of experience from many boards I've served on in my community, which allows me a perspective needed in determining priorities and budgeting, respectively. And I can offer an immense appreciation for fostering and utilizing research development that benefits our great state. My professional experience in economic development allowed me quite often to partner with communities, businesses, and educational institutions, not only to provide the best trained workforce in Minnesota, but also to enhance our own resources to export to the rest of the world. I believe these qualities would bring a positive addition to the Board of Regents and would be honored to serve as one of them. I assure you, I would be an enthusiastic advocate for such a wonderful education system in the state and ask for your vote. Right. Thank you.
3 minutes goes by real fast. Mr. McMillan.
Thank you, Chair Nornes, Chair Fishbach, members of the Joint Committee. I want to quickly just review some relevant experience that I think is important. Talk about my passion for the board and for the university, and then a couple priorities that I'd pursue if I have the opportunity for a second term on the board. I have 30-plus years of experience in the private sector, the last two decades of that as an executive at Minnesota Power and its parent company, Elite. Importantly, that has put me on the management side of the board management interface, which is vitally important experience in terms of what good governance means from a leadership standpoint of an organization. Got extensive board leadership and board governance experience at the Minnesota Chamber, which I had the opportunity to chair, St. Luke's Hospital and System in Duluth, the U of M Foundation, the St. Lawrence Seaway, all of which spans public, private, for-profit, not-for-profit opportunities, and regional, state, national, and some international experience. I combine that experience with a deep and passionate understanding of what it is that makes the communities, the people, the businesses, and the natural resources of northern Minnesota work and what they need from their university to work even better. I live in Duluth. I actually live across the street from UMD, where nearly a quarter of our undergraduate degrees are being issued across the system today. It's an increasingly important part of our graduate education mission and some of our most important work in the professional school realm with the pharmacy, medical schools, and other elements up there. So our research, education, and outreach mission is alive and well in the 8th District. I'm a third-generation U graduate myself, an undergraduate degree from UMD, a law degree from the university here on the Twin Cities campus. My children are fourth-generation grads. My son graduated last year from the College of Science and Engineering. I mention that because the student experience is not an abstraction for me, just like UMD and this campus are not an abstraction for me. I have a good portal into that student experience, and it's relatively recent. If afforded an opportunity to serve again, I would work on these priorities. One, continuing to better align the university's research and education missions with the needs of the communities, peoples, businesses of the state, and better prioritizing access and affordability for Minnesotans, meaning we need to continue to refine and rethink our admissions and tuition strategies and our long-term enrollment strategy, a process we've had underway now at the board for a better part of a year. Finally, improving transparency and a better focus on fiscal discipline are always things we need to spend time on. So thank you for the opportunity to be here today, and thanks for the opportunity I've had over the last 6 years.
Thank you both for your 3 minutes. And right now, we'd like to begin the question and answer period. And we have the questions first, and Representative Pulaski.
Yes, same question as I've asked the others. Should the Regents be voting on the multi-million dollar athletic contracts, and should all Regent votes be recorded?
McMillan.
Chair Nornes, Representative Pulaski, yes, we should be, and I believe you'll find us debating that on Friday. We should be voting. That is a huge fiscal undertaking, and you will see me voting to approve that, and we'll see where it goes on Friday, but we should be. And we did institute a refined look this year at the board leadership level and overall as to how we might better track and record votes for the first time in my 6 years on the board, and we've actually got a process in place now so that if there's a voice vote, that's that. If there's a show of hands, we'll get that recorded. And as one of the prior regents, I think Regent Devine noted, we do have everything's publicly recorded, but we are tracking to a much higher degree how individuals vote if they so want it recorded. Paul?
Representative Pulaski, the answer to both your questions is absolutely. It's the best way to be transparent and hold our fiscal responsibilities, hold the university accountable for that. So I agree completely with both questions. Yes.
More questions? Representative Breyer?
Mr. Chair. Yeah. Back to the question about process. Ms. Hall, did you participate in the first advisory council vetting of candidates, or is this the first time that you've appeared before any group as a candidate for Regent?
As a newcomer, this is my first experience going through this application process, and I was aware of the committee process, how that all works. I was the reason why I put my name into this is that I was disappointed that there wasn't a lot of interest or enthusiasm in our region to select several candidates. Look, there's two of us here tonight, so
there's three.
Three, actually, yes, right. I threw my name in there just because I've always wanted to serve in this way, and I just thought this is a really good opportunity to get out there, and I apologize for missing that process, but I'm glad that this is available to us to be able to meet with all of you and seek your nomination here and apply here in front of your committee. I appreciate that.
Okay, and then as a process as a whole, do you think it's a good idea to have this advisory committee, or should, you know, now can, you're new to the process, mm-hmm. Here for the first time, can you comment then on the process, and then to also hear from Mr. McMillan too about what you think about the process?
Paul?
I think it's a good process to have in place as an advisory. I think there's room for improvement. I think it should be maybe do a little more work in seeking out qualified applicants. But at the end of the day, I think the real process exists in this room. Minnesotans hold you accountable for your selections to the Board of Regents. So I think it's more important that we reach out to the legislators and we're all held accountable at the end of the day at the University of Minnesota as well as at the Legislature for Minnesotans.
Representative Isaacson, or Senator. I'm sorry. I didn't give McMillan a chance to respond. Thank you.
Chair Nornes and Representative Pryor, I would just offer this observation. You need some kind of a vetting process. I don't know that the RCAC process is the best. I've been through it a second full times now, 11 and 17. It does work. I think the biggest challenge that you have is getting representation from around the state on the RCAC. And I would just note there were no 8th District members from the 8th Congressional District on the RCAC this year. So that may or may not have had something to do with the number of applicants. But I think if that process is sufficiently robust and there's good statewide representation across the geography of a district and the population centers and the places where the university has assets across the 8 districts, it probably can work. Does it always work the best? Perhaps not. I think Mr. Benson noted it's an arduous he may have used the word weird. I don't know that I'd use that one, but it is a process, and it does get us to the point of giving you a shorter list than you would have had otherwise.
Senator Isaacson.
Chair Nornes, it's good to see you again and hear you call my name, even if it is with the illustrious position of Senate, of course, right?
Point of order.
Point of order? I thought I put enough sarcasm into that really weren't sure where I was going with it. So, anyways.
We still like you.
Thanks, I appreciate it. It's good to be here. Unfortunately, I have seen now, in my very short time in the legislature, this position get politicized again, unfortunately, and it's really disgusting. And I'm really frustrated. And so I was not aware of your decision or the decision to bring your nomination forward until recently, and I didn't have a chance to talk to you. Didn't know, frankly, that you existed and that this was going to happen. And so now we're in this point where we're going to have a discussion and possibly vote. So I did some asking around about that, and as I looked at the where you're at and who I know you and some research, and I just want to ask a couple questions, if that's all right.
Yes, it is. Go ahead.
Thank you,
Isaacson.
I know that we can pretend like we're supposed to be nonpartisan, but you have a fairly partisan background on one side, which is the spoils of victory for the party that wins. I get that. But what I had heard consistently as a theme was that one of the driving factors for you to wanting to be on the board, or for the group that wants to put you on the board, relates to the use of stem cell research, or excuse me, aborted fetal tissue research at the U. And I'm just wondering if you could clarify if you have a stance on that, and where you stand with the use of that tissue as research in trying to solve many of the diseases that our society faces. And I'd like actually both candidates to answer that question.
Okay. Beginning with Paul.
I do have a position on that issue. Mm-hmm. However, that is not the reason why I stepped up to seek this position. Mm-hmm. The reason why I want to be a Board of Regent is, number one, maybe it's because I'm a parent of college students, And I see in Minnesota that we have this excellent educational system, but sometimes I think, number one, it's growing more unaffordable for our Minnesota kids to attend. I sense from the university system that we focus more on trying to recruit from outside the state. They get a pretty good deal attending the University of Minnesota system here at the expense of our own kids. So the reason why I'm running really is to support our Minnesota families and our students and make sure that they're the priority, that they have the opportunities for this excellent educational system here in Minnesota. Another reason why I chose to run is because I'm concerned about are we balancing our books properly? I want to see somebody on the board that can manage those budget issues, prioritizing whatever projects are that don't hinder the cost of kids in Minnesota going to school any further. I'm very concerned that we continue to build in this state, and we've got some great facilities, and some of it's needed, but my concern is not to place that burden on the backs of our Minnesota students in higher tuition costs. So that's a huge concern for me as well. As far as another area, research and development, including stem cell research.
Aborted fetal tissue cell.
Fetal tissue, right. The University of Minnesota has an excellent reputation, brilliance in doing research and development in Minnesota. It's known nationwide for being an excellent research center. My position would be, I would like to pursue other methods of research besides utilizing fetal tissue first and foremost beforehand. I just think it's more, I just believe that we've got the brilliance to do other kinds of research that it's not necessarily needed to include fetal tissue. That's my position.
McMillan.
Chair Nornes and Senator Isaacson, as a world-class medical school with an academic health center the caliber that we have, we need to be doing leading cutting-edge research across the spectrum. And I believe that research has to be lawful, it has to be moral, and we have to be in compliance with the rules, whether they be state or federal or both. And I think that when we are that, we should be letting our researchers do their job. I was supportive last year of an effort to fund a research effort to look at how might we go forward to get adequate amounts of fetal tissue to do that kind of research. That didn't go forward. I don't know why. The board was not involved in that decision. And I've heard quite a bit from members on both sides of the equation here about that. I would remain supportive of an effort to look very hard at what can we do to use non-elective tissue if that's feasible and possible. But we do want to be doing the most cutting-edge research possible, and for Minnesotans like my dad who has Parkinson's, we want to be solving those kind of things. So,
Senator Isaacson.
Thank you. Well, I would be remiss if we were to look at the Regents and find out that we're getting into that level of micromanaging when it comes to their research. And I'll be frank with you that the only thing I heard from my Republican friends on why you're being nominated was specifically to address that issue on more than one Republican conversation I had. And so I'm not doubting the sincerity you have on what I think was a fairly well-stated point about why you want to be a regent. I think it's that's a good balanced approach, and I would support that concept. It would be very troubling down the road when looking at future things with the U if I were to discover that that focus became a primary focus on the board for any of the regents engaged. And so that is a concern that I have moving forward in the way we approach. And, you know, can I just speak one other thing to this whole process, fairly disastrous in the way we've approached this, both in having an entire committee that we're now disregarding in two different districts in the way we're reporting people because people aren't happy with who we've appointed and creating. I'm not even sure why this committee even still exists if we're going to just continue to nominate people off the floor that weren't part of the vetting process. because the majority party decided they want some. And that's the spoil of the victory. You got the votes. I respect that. But then let's not have the pretense of a committee and drag these poor people through a ridiculous amount of crap when they're not even going to get a chance to run and get beat by someone who didn't go through the process. That's insane. And I'm not blaming you for that. I'm saying the process itself absolutely positively needs to be fixed. And this is a primary example of that. Thank you.
That's a statement. I don't think it needs a response. Senator Cohen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not sure I agree totally with Senator Isaacson to the extent that we had the nomination of Mr. Swigum, and whether or not we support him or not, we certainly know of his position relative to the University of Minnesota from over the years, his commitment to the university, his involvement with issues of higher education. So I have a pretty good sense of Mr. Swigum, but Ms. Hall, I'm sorry, I don't know you and don't know your positions. You indicated that one of the reasons you'd like to be on the Board of Regents is that you're apparently the parent of students at the university, and you are representative of parents who have kids at the University of Minnesota. So that's true of probably 200,000, 300,000 people in the state of Minnesota. What distinguishes you from those folks? We've heard from other candidates in terms of their involvement with the University of Minnesota. And I'm not talking about the incumbent regents as such, but we've heard from other non-incumbent candidates about their direct involvement with issues involved with the University of Minnesota, with higher education, with corporate life in the state of Minnesota. What particular expertise do you bring to the Regents relative to what you've done? What's your background in terms of some of these broader issues, not just simply as a parent?
I should point out we're getting very close to the end of our allotted time. So.
Right. And, I was fortunate enough to meet with the majority of you, and I wish I had time to meet with many more of you. I apologize for not being able to reach out to all of you. I did bring tonight my resume. If you're interested, I would love to share that with you. My experience, I've been very active in my community. I try to be involved in any way I can. I've sat on many boards where nonprofits that we just do our best in our community to make it a better place. I guess my passion lies in offering up my energy, my enthusiasm, my skills just making a better place for my world. So that's my involvement with my community boards. I have experience with budgeting and prioritizing as a result of that. I think one of my biggest strengths is being approachable and being a listener and reaching out to the experts in the fields in anything I've worked in. I tried to be a listener to do that. Oh, I didn't realize I had time, but I worked in economic development that quite often sent me around the state of Minnesota, partnering with businesses and communities and our public institutions, education institutions.
We are officially out of the time allotted for the questions, but we'd give Mr. McMillan a chance to respond. Was there anything in there that you'd like to respond to?
I don't know. There was a question for me there from Senator Cohen.
And I apologize for those that now have come forward with questions, and we need to move forward with the vote. So,
wait, Mr. Chair?
Yes, Ms.
I don't have a question. I just have a comment, if I could, please. I would be remiss. Excuse me.
Go ahead.
I would be remiss if I did not express my concern and disappointment in Senator Isaacson's remarks. I think that he cast a pretty broad brush there. And I would prefer if persons would not presume to know my motivations without talking with me directly. So I would just say that as a matter of right. Thank you.
I don't think we want to get into
I have that. A clarifying question.
Procedural question?
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm sorry. For Ms. Hall, how long ago did you work in economic development?
Well, you know, I've been active in doing many things.
We're out of time.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Long ago.
Thank you very much.
Okay, the House will be voting first in this case.
Chair Nornes.
McMillan.
Representative Christensen.
McMillan.
Representative Pulowski.
McMillan.
Representative Albright.
McMillan.
Representative Anselmo.
McMillan.
Representative Bernardi.
McMillan.
Representative Daniels.
Okay.
Representative Haley.
McMillan.
Representative Heintzman.
Paul.
Representative Jessup.
McMillan.
Representative Lean.
McMillan.
Representative Omar.
McMillan.
Representative Pryor.
McMillan.
Representative Schultz.
McMillan.
Representative Whalen.
Paul.
Representative Zerwas.
McMillan. Chair Fischbach.
Paul.
Vice Chair Dreheim.
Paul.
Senator Clausen.
McMillan.
Senator Abler.
Paul.
Senator Anderson.
McMillan.
Senator Cohen.
McMillan.
Senator Isaacson.
McMillan.
Senator Jensen.
McMillan.
Senator
McMillan.
Okay, the votes have been cast, and the name that'll be the candidate that'll be advanced to the joint convention will be David McMillan. Now to the at-large. And we have four candidates for the at-large position: Tom Devine, Kent Moldy, Ken Powell, and John Regal. And alphabetical seems to work, so we'll start with Tom Devine.
In the interest of time, I will yield my the remainder of my time back to the chair. I've already made my statement. I don't need to make it twice. Thank you.
Appreciate that. Thank you very much. Kent Moldy?
Yeah, Chair Nornes and Chair Fischbach, members of the Higher Education Committee. There are five traits that set me apart from the other three candidates seeking the same position. Number one, I was born and raised on a farm. I purchased the farm from my parents, and for the last 42 years, I've owned and actively managed the farm. I will be the advocate for agriculture, education, and research on the University of Minnesota Regents. I spent my entire undergraduate, graduate level medical school, and postgraduate studies in diagnostic radiology at the University of Minnesota. This resonates with today's student experience. This experience is unique and will allow me to be an advocate for both the students and faculty at all five university campuses. I am the only Twin Cities Metro physician among the existing regents or candidates. 35% of the University of Minnesota budget is medical related. Last June, the merger efforts of the Academic Health Center and Fairview System fell apart. This merger is vital to both parties. I will be the catalyst on the Board of Regents to restart the merger talks and to bring the merger to fruition. On the four, I have 22 years of board experience. Differentiating me from the other candidates, however, is that I am now retired. I have no other board commitments. I can spend as much time as I need on the issues presented to the Board of Regents. Finally, I will be the Board of Regents champion for sexual abuse awareness, education, and prevention. My only daughter was sexually assaulted her freshman year of college. The long-term effects, PTSD, depression, inability to concentrate, are gut-wrenching to watch as a close family member, and more specifically, a father. The recent headlines in the news clouds and tarnishes the reputations of such a magnificent university. I will do everything in my power to promote the proper tone and culture on the Board of Regents, which will be directed to the president and the administration and down to the students
and most definitely the student athletes. Thank you. Ken Powell.
Chair Fishback, Chair Norris, members of the committee, thank you. It's been it's an honor to meet over 50 representatives and senators over the past several weeks. And from these meetings, it's clear that you care deeply about the U and you're proud of it. But there are concerns that I heard repeatedly. First, you had many questions about the proper role for the board. Passive, or is the role to probe and challenge? Many of you are concerned about students we're losing to other states and feel we're not serving our rural communities well. You have deep concerns about administrative and overhead costs and what we can do to keep the university affordable. There are concerns that the university's not been transparent on key issues of concern to legislator. And finally, I heard concerns about our reputation and what we can do to get the negative stories off the front page. And with these concerns in mind, here's what I hope to bring to the board. First, I bring strong board governance experience. General Mills, Medtronic, Federal Reserve Bank, all big and complex like the U. And these experiences have taught me that a board's role is to challenge and to probe, to make sure the priorities are right, the strategy is effective, that the leaders are moving the U in the right direction. I bring strong experience in the areas of food, agriculture, and biosciences, all crucial to our future. And the continued development of our medical sciences complex is a priority for me, given the importance of this activity to our state. I think that you should do more to help the Minnesota farmer. Our big ag sector faces big challenges, low commodity prices, changing technology, issues around sustainability, and these farmers have told me they could use some help. One of our largest ag organizations, the AgriGrowth Council, is supporting my candidacy due to my engagement in ag issues over the years. I believe the funding environment for public universities will continue to be challenging because an aging population means legislators are going to face tough decisions around health care and care for the elderly. And this means that the university must work very hard to tightly control administrative costs and must continue to strengthen our endowment so we have more privately raised funds to help kids afford the U. I don't see any way around a high focus on these two activities, and I bring experience here that would help. I'll work to get the U off the front pages. These negative stories hurt us. In business, we work hard to anticipate problems, then we develop plans to reduce the possibility that these events will happen, and I'll bring this approach to the U as well. And finally, culture counts. I think one of the primary jobs of a leader is to stand for core values. Everybody at General Mills knows our values, and they know if you break certain rules, you get fired. At the U, we must hold all our students to our standards. All our research must be done at the highest ethical standard, and our leaders must model our values at all times. So Chair Fishback and Nornis, committee members, with your support, I'll bring these beliefs and experiences to the board. Thank you.
Before we move on, I did make one small mistake, and I should have called for nominations. So are there any of the nominations for the at-large? See, one. We need two more.
Okay.
Oh, I see. I should announce who it is.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I was respecting you so much, waiting for you to call my name.
I'm just learning.
Thank you very much. Okay. I put Tammy Lee Stanek's name in a nomination for at-large regent.
Okay. Stanek's name has been nominated. Are there two more hands? Okay. On the Senate side? Two? Okay. So we add Stanek then to the witness table? Thank you. Sorry about that. We don't do this very often. Okay, we'll continue in alphabetical order, I guess, because
there you go.
She will be last. Ken Powell. Oh, you're done. I'm sorry. John Riegel.
Thank you, Chair Norris, Chair Fishback, senators, representatives. My name is John Riegel. Thank you for the opportunity to present my credentials for Regent at Large. I'm a product of an East Side St. Paul working class family. My father was a graduate of the University of Minnesota College of Pharmacy, and he co-owned a small drugstore right here on University Avenue in St. Paul. He brought me to the university when I was 5 years old, so I was exposed to the Twin Cities campus at a very early age. I also am a proud graduate of the University of Minnesota, the Carlson School of Management, where exceptional faculty such as Walter Heller, Ed Cohen, Andy Whitman had a profound impact on my degree choice and my career decisions. Rather than jumping into the corporate world right away, I made a decision to enter the public sector, doing public finance, risk management, and labor relations with the city of St. Paul. It was a phenomenal experience for me. For the last 18 years, I've been working in risk management and government affairs for Securian Financial Group in downtown St. Paul. I see the world through the lens of a risk manager, which I believe is a good thing, especially at a board level. I've chaired the boards of directors for two local and international insurance groups. In addition, I've chaired the St. Paul Chamber of Commerce, the state's second largest chamber, and the St. Paul Port Authority, quasi-governmental entity with tax levying authority and subject to open meeting laws. I adhere to the basic principles of governance, which are particularly critical in an institution as large and complex as the U. I also believe the Regents must be strategic and hold the administration accountable. I applaud the Regents for establishing four priorities in the current biennium. First, raising the national profile of the U's academic health sciences and medical school is important. This is important for me. My sister was a lifelong diabetic and just experienced a double pancreas and kidney transplant. That does not happen anywhere, a lot of places in the world. We need to continue to raise the profile of this institution. Second, we must establish standards of excellence in the student experience at each campus, not in just the Twin Cities, all five. And I heard that loud and clear from many of you. For example, Crookston, technology, experimental learning, Rochester, health sciences, Morris, emphasis on liberal arts, Duluth, phenomenal pharmacy, insurance, and business. And the Twin Cities is everything else. Third, develop a system-wide strategy that illuminates the 21st century land grant mission and its impact on Minnesota. That, I think, is the most important thing we are facing going forward as an institution. And finally, examine further operational excellence matters, which we are doing in the private sector. And for a $3.6 billion budget, I think we have to show more than $90 million by 2019. And I will add a fifth. We must continue to build and, in some instances, reestablish public confidence in this institution. We must work hard at it. So why do I want to be a Regent? In a nutshell, I believe I have the experience, skills, and passion to make a material difference. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. And Tammy Sandick, I know you've been there earlier. And
I will respect the same rules as Mr. Devine and say thank you for the opportunity to appear before you again today.
All right. Thank you. All right. Beginning the questions, Representative Pawlowski.
Mr. Chair, I think this only applies to the three who have not answered it so far. So should the Regents of the University of Minnesota be voting on the multi-million dollar athletic contracts that sometimes translate into vastly more than that, considering the circumstances? And should all Regent votes be recorded?
Mr. Moldy?
Yes and yes.
Okay. Powell?
Yes and yes.
Regal?
Yes and yes.
Is there a follow-up to that, President Pawlowski?
Mr. Chair, I don't know of another body that handles budgets of this size and scope where we do not have the accountability of recorded votes, and they've weaned themselves off of voting on these types of issues like the athletic contracts. They should be voting on all of the fiscal issues that are before the university so that we know where the Regents stand, and for the other point, so that they know what is going on inside the university. Budget should be as important as anything else, vote by vote, recorded.
Representative Schultz.
Thank you, Chair Nornes. This question is for Mr. Regal. Could you talk about your potential conflict of interest of working at Securian and the relationship between Securian and the University of Minnesota?
Certainly.
Regal.
Mr. Chair and Representative Schultz, I disclosed in my application that I do work for Securing Financial Group, which is one of four, I believe, companies that manages the pension for all employees within the University of Minnesota system, and that if any vote or any conversation came up within the Board of Regents regarding that activity, I would recuse myself.
Representative Pryor. I can just have you pause. I've got a couple of people ahead of you here. Representative Albright.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And to the region candidates, this is for each one of you. It's been mentioned with regard to the frustration over the merger between the University of Minnesota and Fairview and the need for that to get back on track. And so based on your relevant background and experience, I'm wondering if you could give us practical evidence that you have dealt with a certain or specific issue that would pertain in like fashion to how you would resolve the matter of the merger talks between those two entities.
Standick, you want to start?
Sure. Thank you, Representative Albright and chairs. I was part of the leadership team during the Northwest Delta merger, which was one of the largest airline mergers in history. So I'm very familiar with putting together very large, complex organizations with two different unionized workforces and very different competing cultures. It's a very complex financial transaction, but it's a very difficult transaction from a regulatory perspective as well, which is another issue that that merger would have to face. I think the challenges that the university had in getting that deal to come together were on the cultural issues as well. Fairview and the University of Minnesota have two very different cultural approaches to doing things. And I can tell you from my experience with the U that the U isn't always very easy to collaborate with. And I think that Fairview probably had some challenges in getting that deal done. But having been part of a mega merger, I know how to put the teams together and to actually bring that type of a transaction across the finish line.
Mr. Riegel.
Mr. Chair and Representative, I have not been part of a large merger of that magnitude in the past, but I would suggest from a standpoint of efficiency, I would clear communications and transparency with all stakeholders regarding an event like that or a planned event would be paramount.
Powell.
So I've had quite extensive experience over my career involving mergers, formation of joint ventures, acquisitions. So I've had a lot of experience there. I think that in this particular case, very, very ambitious. Many of these kinds of joint ventures or attempts at mergers and joint ventures fail to get off the ground. Many of them fail shortly after they're brought together. So they are difficult. And this one in the end, for a variety of reasons, very complex. There were three different parties working on it. You know, we were unable to move it forward. I think the fact that we now have new leadership at Fairview, and I think the likelihood of different leadership at the university, means the slate is clean, and we can look again at opportunities for closer cooperation between the two institutions.
Moldy.
Yeah, I have been on the scene of this since Fairview got involved with the University Hospital. I was on base at Fairview Riverside Medical Center, which is now the West Campus of the University. I was chief of staff when I made the recommendation on being asked by the lead administrator that we should go ahead and make overtures with the university at that time. We've had culture being melded since the mid-90s here, and so we're about halfway along the route already of getting by the culture aspects of it. As you saw from my resume, I was on staff at Fairview Hospitals for 36 years. I was on staff at the University of Minnesota Hospital for the last 15 years. I know the stakeholders. I am familiar with the touch points on the institutions. As is mentioned, we've got a new CEO for Fairview, James Herford, and we've got
a new, or the UMP, University of Minnesota positions. Bobby Daniels has given her date of departure in the last quarter of this coming year. And the Academic Health Center, it's so vitally necessary that we get this done. The three pods of the Academic Health Center were set forth in the principles from the 1800s. The part that takes care of patients, the part that does education, the part that does research. The two pods were supported by the clinical. That doesn't work anymore. The payer systems are one low rate, whether you're out in Wadena or whether you're at the University of Minnesota. That large base is needed. And for the educational end, rather than having the bone marrow transplant patients and the other oddities at the University of Minnesota, getting the medical students out to all those community hospitals, getting them taught about heart failure, pneumonia, diabetes, so critical, just makes sense. The research, getting the huge Fairview system involved, gives so much traction with all the volume that you end up with as far as the patient mix. This should go forward. I know the stakeholders. I'm retired. I no longer have any skin in the game.
Okay. Devine.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The last 3 years, this issue of the medical area and medical education has been the highest of the Board of Regents' priorities. We started out 3 years ago with a very in-depth understanding of what brought us to the point of selling the hospital at the point that we did. And much work was done to really understand what was the context of that decision in terms of when the board made it at that point and what needed to happen going forward. I was an early advocate for bringing in an outside resource, both to represent that really the entities within the university so we could balance the whole thing out in terms of how we would go through and develop a decision-making process. Neither Fairview nor the University of Minnesota have gone through this type of a merger or this kind of an acquisition situation, and I felt and I advocated internally within the board that we'd take a much more aggressive approach in how we actually put the transaction together as such. That transaction failed last summer, and some of the items that have already been mentioned here, we are now in a reset of that decision process right now going forward. The other thing I want to mention is the relationship here for the people of Minnesota of the payer, the delivery system, and then the research element and the teaching element all need to come together. And we see at the national level there is going to be a reset again, once again, of what's going to happen here for the people of Minnesota. And that is very important. The governor made a gesture in a meeting over at the university at one point and said Mayo and the University of Minnesota need to come together. And I have been an advocate of understanding about how we go about that delivery and how we go about that in a very structured, organized way, which we've not yet entered into altogether. Like I said, we're at the cusp of doing that. And to make this final point, Dr. Lillehei, the university has a long history of having patient feed and doing breakthrough research. And I use as an example within my immediate family, Dr. Lillehei, who did open heart surgery, which later became called bypass surgery. His first 12 patients all passed away. They were elderly in terms of what at the point that they did it. My wife's father at 42 was the 13th patient who lived 28 years after having that procedure at the University of Minnesota. And so I'm intimately involved and familiar with the research opportunities of what it is that we're doing at the University of Minnesota. And so with that, it is a high board priority, and no matter what happens in the regional election cycle, it will continue to be until we get it right for the people of Minnesota. And I am very, very committed on this topic to what we're doing and have a deep understanding of what it is we're trying to accomplish. Thank you.
In the interest of time, the questions between now and the end, if you can keep them as short, and also the answers as short as possible, we'll get more done here. We have two other on the list that need to ask questions. Representative Whalen, you're next.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll try to keep it brief. And just as it was brought up earlier by Representative Isaacson, I appreciate your candidness. And I agree, actually, the RCAC should be looked at for potential reform. But that aside, regarding aborted fetal tissue research. I do have a couple questions, and while I know many in this room and on the committee disagree on many levels, I won't get into the nitty-gritty of the issue, but I will say I disagree that it's micromanaging to ask Regents about this, because there's disagreement within this room and in the legal community on whether or not the University of Minnesota broke the law regarding our fetal tissue disposal statutes. So my first question is, do you believe the University of Minnesota broke our aborted fetal tissue statute? And the second part of the question is, are you pro-life, or would you or support research on aborted fetal tissue?
You're directing that at all candidates?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Okay.
Then we'll go from Divine. You were last, now you're going to be first.
I've spoken on this issue. This is my third region election that I've been through, and I've spoken on this issue extensively, and I've spoken with many of you that are sitting here extensively about the issue. The commitment that I've made is that we will follow the law in the state of Minnesota and what the federal laws are as it relates to this issue. The research work that we do at the University of Minnesota is very important, but it's also important that we follow the law. One of the things that I think that you've heard from the Board of Regents, and you've heard from the researchers at the University of Minnesota, is what is the will of the people of Minnesota, which is, in essence, what is the will of the legislature here in the state of Minnesota relative to this issue? We need to build clarity around that. And I, as I've reached to many of you before, I think that we need to work collaboratively to identify what is it that we want to do as it relates to that issue and frame up that issue for the people of Minnesota. And so with that, I've covered this issue extensively, I know with a number of you individually, and I'm assured that the University of Minnesota will follow whatever the law is that's put before us, both at the federal level and within the state level going forward for the University of Minnesota.
Moldy?
I agree with Mr. Devine on what he has put forward. There is a huge block of citizens of the state of Minnesota that have real problems in this area. As much as is possible, based on this, efforts with stem cell research should at all costs try to work within those sensitivities. I am saying, however, that it is an institution of great research value, and if it is found that the need comes forward, why, I would defer to the law and to the will of the people. And if the legislature gives us a directive on that, certainly we follow it.
Again, if I can remind you, we're going to add an extra 5 minutes because we have five candidates in this case for questions. Again, keep them as brief as possible. Mr. Powell.
Representative Whalen, I don't honestly know if the law was broken. I think it's clear that university wasn't transparent, and that is a concern to me. I don't think it's micromanaging to get into this issue. I think it is, a very important ethical issue. And so I heard that from a number of you, and I respect that. For me, the way forward is, you know, I need to learn more and know more. I want to talk to the researchers on the other side. The idea of non-elective way forward, you know, is of interest to me. But I think what I'll tell you is, I think it's a very, very important issue of ethics. I heard the concerns, and I will listen, and I will pursue this.
Mr. Riegel.
Chair Nornes and Representative, I do not know the answer to that first question as well. And the answer to your second question is, I believe the University of Minnesota and its Board of Regents should abide by the laws of the state of Minnesota.
Stanek.
Thank you very much. I'm not aware of what the law was at the time, but I do know that when the Regents spoke about this, I know that people on the opposite ends of the political spectrum, Peggy Lucas on one side and Regent Laura Broad on the other, both came to the same point of view about how the university should follow the law moving forward. So I think they're getting to the right place about how they approach these very sensitive matters. As we visited when I was in your office, I work for a company that now uses adult human stem cells. You can use your own skin cells now. You don't need to use fetal tissue to grow human cells, tissues, and organs in animals that can be transplanted back to human donors. So I think there is another path forward, but I do support research at the university. I support academic freedom, and I support the Regents finding the right transparent course forward of following the law and doing what's best for the university.
Thank you. Representative Pryor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. New question. If you're elected now for six-year terms, if during that 6 years there is a new president to the University of Minnesota, in terms of process or what characteristics, would you think is important in that role of finding and approving the new president?
Governor, Mr. Moldy.
I didn't catch that. Repeat the last part of that question again.
In terms of either the process for selecting the president or characteristics of the president, what do you think is important for the next president of the University of Minnesota?
Mr. Moldy.
Certainly the academic credentials of the president are important. The administrative skills of the president are important. The dedication to research is very important. The integrity is above all else important. We want to be just absolutely directed to the highest ethical standards at the University of Minnesota.
Mr. Powell?
So I think that this is the most important thing that boards do, is to make sure that we have a successful transition from one leader to another. It's really important and crucial. I think the process should be open and very transparent so that the people of the state can see what's going on. I think the search needs to be as broad as we can possibly make it. I think we want to end up with a very diverse pool, and we want to see candidates with all kinds of backgrounds. I think we're looking for a leader with both a strong academic background, but also strong management and leadership skills that you need to run an institution as complex as the university. We just went through a process at the Federal Reserve Bank. I think that embodied many of these things. It was very successful. It was very open. We reached very broadly, and I think ended, very successfully.
Mr. Riegel.
Chair Norris and Representative, I will echo what my colleague, Mr. Powell, said. I would also suggest that this is indeed the most important part of what a Regent's position is, to have the president in place, whether it be disposing or dismissing or hiring. But the process must be fully transparent to all stakeholders with clear communication at all times.
Standing.
Thank you. I agree with Mr. Powell that this is going to be the most important role of this Board of Regents, hiring the next CEO for the University of Minnesota. I think the next leader needs to be bold and visionary. They need to have a strong background in business and budgetary management. I think they need to balance the needs of the faculty with those of the students. I think they need to keep costs down and make tuition more affordable. I think the next university president should be a bold new leader, and maybe they're a non-traditional candidate. Maybe they're somebody from the business world. And if Mr. Powell is not elected a regent, I vote for him as president of the University of Minnesota.
We have reached the extended time for questions, and I apologize to Senator Abler.
I just have a comment.
You can add a comment, yes.
Thank you. Yes. And I appreciate the time, and I appreciate all the candidates coming forward, and I appreciate this process, even though I don't like it at all for 18 years. But I appreciate those who put themselves through this. But I want to encourage my colleagues to consider the five men and women who are here, and they're all wonderful. They all promise they will do well. One has actually proven what he will do. Tom Devine, if you cut his left arm, it bleeds gold. You cut his right arm, it bleeds maroon. And the leadership he has shown over the years is remarkable. And I hope that we pick him tonight. Thank you.
All right. we are to the point where we vote and... All right, the House will vote first.
Chair Nornis.
Powell.
Representative Christensen.
Powell.
Representative Pawlowski.
Standing.
Representative Albright.
Powell.
Representative Anselmo.
Powell.
Representative Bernardi.
Stanek.
Representative Daniels.
Powell.
Representative Haley.
Powell.
Representative Heinzman.
Powell.
Representative Jessup.
Powell.
Representative Lean.
Maldi.
Representative Omar.
Devine.
Representative Pryor.
Stanek.
Representative Schultz.
Devine.
Representative Whalen.
Devine.
Representative Zerwas.
Devine.
Chair Fischbach.
Pass.
Vice Chair Dreheim.
Paul.
Senator Clausen.
Devine.
Senator Abler.
Devine.
Senator Anderson.
Paul.
Senator Cohen.
Paul.
Senator Isaacson.
Stanek.
Senator Jensen.
Paul.
Senator Newton.
Paul.
Chair Fischbach.
Pass.
We hate to keep you in suspense, but we want to do this right. And we do not have enough votes this first time around to elect a candidate. So we need to vote again. And the rules require the person receiving the fewest votes to then drop out of this round. So Kent Maldi, sorry. Oh, hold it. Regal, I'm sorry. Didn't mean to alarm unduly. Too many voices going on here. So, Regal, I'm sorry. So the rest of them, the other four, will be up this next round for a vote. And again, thank you for being here. And we should, maybe this isn't the right time, but I will say it, that everyone, when we get to the joint convention, anyone can be nominated again, so it's a whole new game.
Thank you for that.
So this. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said that.
We should all boycott this.
All right. I spoke out of turn again. But we're going to vote again. Right. Unless someone has a burning question, we'll then proceed then with the next round of voting.
I have no burning question.
All right.
Well, there's always no.
Then we'll proceed with the vote.
Isaac.
Thank you.
Okay. We'll proceed with the vote.
Chair Nornis.
Powell.
Representative Christensen.
Powell.
Representative Pawlowski.
Devine.
Representative Albright.
Powell.
Representative Anselmo.
Powell.
Representative Bernardi.
Devine.
Representative Daniels.
Paul.
Representative Haley.
Powell.
Representative Heinzman.
Powell.
Representative Jessup.
Powell.
Representative Lean.
Devine.
Representative Omar.
Devine.
Representative Pryor.
Devine.
Representative Schultz.
Devine.
Representative Whalen.
Devine.
Representative Zerwas.
Devine.
Chair Fischbach?
Pass.
Vice Chair Dreheim?
Paul.
Senator Clausen?
Devine.
Senator Abler?
Devine.
Senator Anderson?
Powell.
Senator Cohen?
Devine.
Senator Isaacson?
Devine.
Senator Jensen?
Devine.
Senator Newton?
Powell.
Senator Fishbach?
Pass.
Again, we do not have a majority, neither the House or Senate, I believe. Senator Isaacson.
I just was curious about, can you walk me through how we arrived, maybe I'm not misunderstanding, how are we not having a majority? Is it because we need a majority on both sides?
Yes.
Thank you.
That is correct.
Got it. Yeah.
And this time around, the lowest, Moldy and Stanek. So that leaves us with Devine and Powell.
Chair Nornes?
Powell.
Representative Christensen?
Powell.
Representative Pulowski?
Devine.
Representative Albright?
Powell.
Representative Anselmo?
Powell.
Representative Bernardi?
Devine.
Representative Daniels?
Devine.
Representative Haley?
Powell.
Representative Heintzman?
Powell.
Representative Jessup?
Powell.
Representative Lean?
Devine.
Representative Omar?
Devine.
Representative Pryor?
Devine.
Representative Schultz?
Devine.
Representative Whalen?
Devine.
Representative Zerwas?
Devine.
Chair Fishbach?
Pass.
Vice Chair Dreheim? Senator Clausen?
Devine.
Senator Abler?
Fine.
Senator Anderson?
Powell.
Senator Cohen?
Devine.
Senator Isaacson?
Devine.
Senator Jensen?
Devine.
Senator Newton?
Powell.
Having voted now for the third time, Devine will be the candidate advanced to the Joint Convention. I believe that brings to the end our business for the evening. Again, thanks to all the candidates. Okay. Again, thanks everyone for being here, and the meeting is adjourned.